by the Foundation for Economic Growth and Welfare. In this series, we are focused on policy-oriented research so that we can make a recommendation to the policy, and the discussions are free and fair. And in the past, what we have done is we have invited policymakers, and we have also invited professors whose research has a mark on policymaking. That's exactly what we are going to continue to do in the future also. The session today is being anchored by Dr. Professor, and I'll just hand over the mic to him to conduct the meetings further. I would request everybody to please keep your mics muted so that there's no disturbance and we can all hear to the speaker. Doctor, over to Dr. Ashok Vishwanath.
Yeah, good evening. We are privileged to have a wonderful panel today, and on this such a wonderful and contemporary topic. Vivek, can you see there is a lot of disturbance? Am I audible?
Yeah,
you are audible, sir, but lot of disturbance back
side. Yeah, even I am finding lot of disturbance. Children, can you ask the Vivek to control whatever he can? Because there is a lot of disturbance. Let me proceed.
Vivek will mute everybody. I'm requesting everybody voluntarily to please mute yourself.
Yeah.
There's minimum disturbance.
Right. Now this is better. On behalf of eGrow, I thank you very much, all the panelists who are distinguished. I know how busy they are, but they have found time to talk on this very, very important topic. See, the agriculture is the lifeblood of Indian economy. We have moved a lot of distance from our independence when we were net food importing country, to the self-sufficiency, and then to the net exporting country. The journey has been very strenuous, but in a sense, our agriculture policy has been very, very successful at one end, but on other end, it has bypassed the welfare of the farmer and their income level have not risen as expected. So something is missing. Our agriculture is like a huge aeroplane, but without adequate fuel. What is that fuel? Fuel is, to my mind, to getting the prices right and getting the markets right. And these two things together constitute fuel for the aeroplane. We have the largest, one of the largest agriculture land allocated to the agriculture. We have so many favorite things. We have so much positive things for agriculture. Yet farmers' life have not improved, their welfare has not increased as expected. So these two things, to our mind, there are many other things, but to put the things in a very simple framework, these two things were missing: the correct market and the right prices. In my analysis, these three legislations which recently government brought out in September and or relating to the farmers' produce, and then a kind of prices and essential commodity acts amendment 2020. These three together are the landmark legislations which will put the farmers in a higher pedestal, and their income level is expected to rise in medium to long term, but it immediately is going to give a lot of boost to the farmers' welfare. With these few words, let me open the forum we have distinguished panelists. Let me start with Sukhpal Singh. He is the Professor, Center for Management in Agriculture at Indian Institute of Ahmedabad. I welcome you on behalf of eGrow. Let me also welcome Sukhvinder Singh, he is Professor Economics from Punjab University. Professor Gopal Nayak. He is professor of economics and social science at IIM Bangalore. We have another distinguished panelist, Mrs. Meenakshi Rajiv. She is the chair professor RBI at Institute for Social and Economic Change. We have CL Radish. He is the secretary, Indian Institute of Agriculture Economics. And I welcome Professor Charan Singh. And we have, even in the participant, we have a very distinguished participant who dream of agriculture and always think of. Charan, I think there are a lot of disturbance. Vivek, can you? Vivek, are you listening? We have a lot of disturbance. May I request all others to mute yourself? Thank you very much. I think so. With these few words, I open the floor and request our pro. Let us start with the lady of the lady in the panelist, Mrs. Meenakshi Rajiv. Can we start with these? How do you see these three legislation will benefit the farmers, and how you perceive this, and what is your view on this? Let us get enlightened to this. Over to Meenakshi Rajiv.
Everyone.
Hello.
Everyone.
Yes.
Audible. It is not clear.
Okay. Clear. Maybe then I will come back.
May I request meanwhile Professor Sukhpal Singh to kindly then maybe Meenakshi will join later. So let us make full use of the time allocated to us.
Okay, Dr. Vishandas, how much time I have?
We can at least 15 minutes to each.
Oh, that'd be great. That's very good.
Yeah,
I may not take that much time. I would like to make a few important points. I don't know whether I should ask the address the question you asked, Meenakshi. Let me first thank Eko and Charan make me part of this group of experts, and so many friends I can see there. Let me start by saying that these reforms are not completely new. Yeah, it's not something which was not there earlier. We have seen part of it at the state level. Some part is new, which we need to examine. The process, the mechanism, the speed, maybe debatable, disputable. Yeah, maybe different. Yeah, the coverage may be different. Now it's at the country level. Earlier we had state level. But these things happening with us to a large extent. There are also many misperceptions and misconceptions about these two and a half, I call not three acts actually, because the ECA is basically an amended act. It was there already, it has been only amended. So there are a lot of misperceptions and misconceptions, and that's why people have all kinds of opinions and understanding of these acts. Now, one thing I would like to make clear, that we keep hearing this in public discourse, that as APMCs are Sarkari Mandis. That should be very clear. They are not Sarkari in any sense of the term. They are Sarkari Mandis. They are committees, agriculture produce market committees. I don't need to spend time here because most of you belong to the discipline and you understand they are elected bodies in principle. Yeah, there may be operational problems like operational problem in any other system in this country. There are states which don't even know what an APMC is, for example, Kerala. There are other states which know only APMC, for example, Punjab. Yeah, so therefore, different states have different takes on these reforms. And we have had a course of reforms earlier in the sense that we have been delisting fruits and vegetables or perishables from APMC notification or regulation for the last about 10 years by now. So it is going on, whether UPA or NDA, the reforms have been on the agenda, only the pace has been different. It's also very clear that we keep talking of the role of the state in agricultural markets. It is there, but most of the time it is also not there. Yeah, I don't need to tell you the numbers of how many farmers benefit from state participation in agricultural markets, or what amount of produce or proportion of produce is sold in these markets. Some states, maybe 80%, other states, not even 2%. So it again varies across states. So we have seen alternative markets earlier, other than the APMC. Yeah. So we have seen contract farming, which has been going on for the last, even before I was born, since 1960s. In seed, all the seed companies have been doing contract farming across Indian states. Punjab was the pioneer in bringing contract farming to agriculture in 1989 with the Pepsi project. Yeah, so then we also have, let's recall that the State APMC Act amendments as per the Model Act of 2003 and then 2017 have permitted contract farming, have permitted private wholesale markets, and permitted direct purchase, all permission granted by the local APMC or the state level agricultural marketing board or department. So permissions were taken, but it was not that they could go scot-free. They still had to pay the fees and charges, which is the opposite case now, that now when you have this new trade area, you don't need to pay any fees or taxes or cesses. You're completely buying without incurring any additional buying cost, unlike in a APMC market yard or sub yard. So if the objectives of these reforms are to improve efficiency of agriculture markets, to make them more effective for farmers, lowering the cost of selling, and for the buyer, lowering the cost of buying, and bring what is known as one nation, one market, or one country, one market in agriculture, then let's look at what role these reforms can play. But I would like to keep aside the policy aspects of the government of India or the states. Generally, people mix up policy and regulation. I would not like to do that. There are 100 plus things which government can do in terms of improving policy. But to me, today's agenda is not about policy. It's about 3 acts or 2.5 acts, which is about regulation. Yeah. So I would stick to that, not go beyond that. Keeping in mind the experience of direct purchase in India for the last 20 years and contract farming for the last 70 years. Yeah. So I will go by that. And before I get into the real issues, I would just like to draw your attention to a few misperceptions and misconceptions. One of them is, like, I also heard some of my friends talking about it other day, that when we say contract farming, they say it's about corporate farming. It is not. I'm willing to stick my neck out and say it has nothing to do with corporate farming in any sense of the term. Because in corporate farming, companies own or lease in land to undertake their own farming activity. Here, that is simply not allowed in India, because we still have ceilings on Land Holdings Act. We still have restrictions on land leasing by any non-agriculturist. So let's not mix up things. Contract farming does not in any way mean corporate farming. Then some people confuse it with futures markets. That is really no way one can stretch the imagination that far, that you say contract farming is about bringing futures markets into play. No way, because that's a different market mechanism altogether. The third is, which is again not a statement of fact, saying that contract farming is not beneficial for farmers. Again, I'm willing to stick my neck out and look, I've done dozens of studies on this across India, across crops, across types of farmers. Contract farming is always more profitable than open market sales. But that, let me qualify that statement by three things. One, that it always costs more to participate in contract farming production. Yeah. Two, that small farmer generally cannot participate in these kind of arrangements. Most of the contract farming so far has happened with medium and large farmers. Yeah. So that the saying that contract farming does not benefit farmers is not even half truth. It's a lie, complete lie. In most situations, contract farming is more beneficial to farmers than the open markets, the kind of markets we have in this country. Now, please don't compare contract farming with an MSP-based crop. Yeah, you would see that very little contract farming is taking place wherever there is MSP. Yeah. On the other hand, we also have crops which are doing very well without MSP. So neither this nor that is the way to go. Last point about contract farming, that contracting companies will take away farmers' land. There cannot be anything farther than this in terms of being away from the truth. There is no way a company can lay any claim on a contracting farmer's land. The act clearly says twice actually that the contracting agency cannot sell, lease or mortgage farmer's land. It can't even claim its dues from farmer's agriculture land or assets, even if farmer runs away and is a defaulter. So farmer's land is completely protected. It is always protected in India, even the under the APMC based contract farming law. So let's not be worried about that part. So that is my take on the contract farming misperceptions. I'll just take a couple of minutes to talk about similar misperceptions about certain other things about the general stuff. Maybe I'll come to that little later, but let me find the problems now. Problem with these two acts which I would deal with. One is this farmer produce trade and commerce, which in now we have started calling it APMC Bypass Act 2020. The other is farmer empowerment and protection and this and that, finally saying Contract Farming Act 2020. Let me highlight what is problematic in this, which will explain some of the trouble which is going on and which will also tell us how we didn't do our job adequately in terms of framing these new laws. Yeah. Now, the way it defines a trader, the APMC Bypass Act, the way it defines trader is problematic because it includes an agent. Yeah, we know in APMC system, there is a Kacha Artiya and there is a Pakka Artiya. Kacha Artiya is a commission agent and Pakka Artiya is a trader who can buy. Commission agents don't buy. Many times one entity has both the licenses, but still. So if you are saying trader, how can you include commission agent in that? That has been included, which is not good. The way trader is defined, it is in fact very surprising that the way the purpose of buying is defined, even a homemaker, when she goes to a farmer's market to buy vegetables, she also has to have a PAN card. Or if I reverse the argument, anybody who has a PAN card can go and ask any farmer, I want to buy your produce, whether it's 10 tons or 2 kgs. I don't think that is a fair thing from the farmer's perspective to do, that we allow anybody and everybody to go and start dealing with the farmer. It is not a very wise proposition to do. The second is that when we say that we want to free interstate trade through this act, yeah? So the problem is how far you treat an agriculture produce as agricultural produce. I'm saying this because if you go by this logic, then anything which is food, which is agri-produce based, whether chocolates or bread or sugar cubes, then everything will remain agriculture produce. If you don't say we are only dealing with first level transaction between a farmer and a buyer. To me, that has been agriculture transaction in India. That should have been the only agriculture transaction, the way it is defined, but it includes everything. That is similar to But FPO, they have been asking, the Farmer Producer Organization of Cooperatives, have been asking Dr. Kurian, died asking this, never got it, saying that since we are farmer-owned bodies, we buy and deal with farmers' produce. Since income tax in India is exempted from agriculture income is exempt from income tax, so FPO should also be exempted from income tax. So this is similar to that kind of argument, which is again not very valid argument. So once you have bought some produce, the other entity doesn't remain in the picture. So that problem has been created here by saying that any transaction, whether intrastate or interstate, is an agricultural transaction. Yeah, so that needs to be looked into. More quickly, let me just say, make one statement about this, that if we say, and I'm all for regulation, I don't believe in completely free markets, especially in agriculture, in a country like India, the smallholder context we have. So if you want to look at what free markets can do, please go to Bihar and have a look at scenario. Bihar did away with the APMC Act in 2006. We have 14 years experience. Let's go and see how things have improved there, whether agriculture investments have followed, flowed in, whether farmers are getting MSP or better prices, or private markets have been set up, or new trade areas giving a fair deal to farmers. I don't think that is the picture there. So we should have learned something from Bihar and appropriately provided for adequate protection of farmer interest while opening up these markets. Now let me come to Contract Farming Act, because that's where I have soiled my hands most of the time. I'm sorry to say, I have not seen more poorly designed legislation on this earlier than this. Yeah, I appeal that we should go back to the APMC Act 2003 contract farming part of it, which was much better. Much better. So I had issues with that also, but much better to take into account the farmer interest. But we have not. The way it's called farming agreement, the way farmer is defined, yeah, even FPOs being made as a farmer. Now we know FPOs never participate in agriculture production. They facilitate sale of produce or purchase of agriculture inputs, but they're clubbed with farmer. On the other hand, I can give you dozens of names of FPOs which are already doing contract farming with farmers. They're actually on the contracting side, not on the supplying side. They're on the buying side. So that kind of thing. So that also needs to be looked into. Today, contract farming is not a simple activity. It's a very, very sophisticated arrangement, because it's about food safety, food quality, export competitiveness, and even fair and ethical practices. Have we taken that into account? It's good that for the first time, this act mentioned social and environmental standards and food safety also being important, but it just mentions, it doesn't say that they should be part of the contract arrangement. More importantly, now this is the sort of more important part, that we kept saying that APMC is not doing a good job. We need to give choice to farmers. Very well said thing. Yeah, APMCs are not the best performing. There are a lot of loopholes. I agree to that. They need a lot of reform. But if you go back and say any bonus or any premium a contracting agency wants to pay to farmers over and above the pre-agreed price, you'll have to link it up to APMC price. How fair is that? How can you make a contracting agency which is trying to independently work with a farmer by discovering independently its prices go and link it up to that bad APMC, which doesn't discover its prices well? Where was the need for this linkage? There is no need to link it up. So going back to that same mandi does not speak very well of the act. Now to me, Contract Farming Act actually is more about facilitation and promotion of corporate entities rather than regulation. It does not adequately protect farmer interest. We should have done much more than this than has been attempted. So I think I would just conclude in a minute by saying that the way we are looking at alternatives, that is also no good. So let's be very careful. Simply because you want to suggest something doesn't mean it's better than what has been provided for. For example, people saying, let's do cooperative farming. There cannot be a more perverse idea than this at this stage in this country. We tried cooperative farming. It never worked. It will never work. It doesn't require this consideration because small farm is the most efficient farm in India. Production is not an issue. Farmers need marketing solutions. They need to interface the market effectively, buying and selling. So that we need pre-production and post-production aggregation we need, but not cooperative farming. Then yesterday even I heard another perverse idea. State should do farming. Last point. Very important points. I want to make them. Punjab tried corporate farming. I don't know how many of you know. They went up to 2,000 hectares. Punjab said farmers don't want to diversify. State will do it on its own. They employed managers and full-time workers and whatnot. People are still waiting for the land they have leased, for the rent to be paid. Court cases are going on. Whoever can think that state can do farming better than farmers? Thirdly, we kept abusing the middleman, intermediary. Now suddenly many farmer friends and my friends and experts are saying, no, they are not that bad. What has changed overnight? Once this act has come in, we have started defending the Arthiya. If Madhya Pradesh could remove them in 85 without any noise, why can't we do away with them now? We have FPCs, we have PACs, we have cooperatives. We have new traders coming in now. Last and worst thing, make MSP a legal right. Please, my request is please don't kill Indian agriculture market by asking for this. I know farmers aren't getting MSP, but making it a legal right for all crops, for all farmers, is not the way. That can be a biggest disservice to the Indian agriculture for the future if we get into that kind of rut. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor.
Sorry for taking a few minutes more.
Yeah, it's fine. I think we'll make up somewhere. And I think you gave a very good exposition of different aspects of these three pieces of legislation. We'll again discuss on this, and if the time permits, we'll discuss more in greater detail. May I now request Professor Gopal Nayak to give your views on our three legislation and related issue. Our question will be same, and may I request kindly confine yourself to the 10 minutes so that we have enough, because I am anticipating many questions so that we can discuss further, and if the time permits, we'll have another round. So kindly restrict yourself to the 10 minutes. Over to Professor Gopal Nayak.
Okay. Good evening, everybody. Thank you, Ashok, for giving me this opportunity. Also, Charan. Let me be very brief on my comments. And Dr. Sukhpal Singh has already talked about in greater detail about the three bills and their implications. Few points I want to make are, one is, of course, what are the nice things about the bills? I will start with the sort of positive side of the bills. So one is, of course, it increases the choice to the farmers in terms of selling their produce to different agencies without the APMC coming in the way of collecting market fee and so on. In fact, as Sukhpal has said, in many states, these things are anyway happening actually. Many farmers are selling their produce to the village traders. There are also some direct buying is there, informing the APMCs and paying their fees. So this will help in a little bit more in terms of anybody coming in and buying from the farmers. And therefore, to some extent, it increases the choice to the farmers in terms of number of buyers. The second implication of this, the first bill, is basically it helps in interstate trade. Of course, the aim is actually the farmer should be able to take it across the state and sell it, but that may not happen unless there are some border areas where you know, it actually, even now it is happening, you know, between border areas, the farmers do go across the state and sell their produce. It may facilitate traders a little bit more, and therefore certain restrictions that are there between the states would ease out. Whether that benefits farmers or not is a question mark. Some of the systems that are already existing in terms of farmers moving their produce to another state may need not be there now. So therefore, it might help a little bit to some of the farmers. The third one is, to some extent in the contract farming, the dispute settlement arrangement is much more legalized. Whether it is going to work better or not, we don't know. But I think it's a, in terms of legal provision, it is slightly better. So therefore, those who would like to have contract farming may have better avenues now to settle disputes. Of course, if you look at contract farming, the contractors, you know, contract farming does not happen wherever the buyers see that there is a problem. So in fact, you know, they don't want to go to court or any other agencies. So maybe it is going to, you know, facilitate to some extent. Again, I don't see a large impact of that on the current system. The next one is, of course, because the Essential Commodities Act is removed, so for individual traders can have larger stocks and so on. So that might lead to certain amount of larger volume being dealt by individual traders. So that is possibly will happen. The last thing that I wish it would happen is basically there should be a push for the APMC to be farmer friendly. So far, you know, APMCs are not really farmer friendly. They do not cater to the needs of farmers. Again, basically because many of them are captured by the commission agents, traders, and so on, and therefore they don't serve the requirements of the farmers. But hopefully now they have to be in competition with the rest of the sales arrangement, so that in order to attract more and more farmers, they will have to provide services which are required by the farmers. I think I would you know, that there is one possible outcome of that. Whether it will happen or not is of course a big question mark is there. Now, what are the concerns? The concerns are, number one is, of course, you know, large part of our farming community, more than 85% or so, are small and marginal farmers. And this trend is in fact increasing. So the farm size of holdings are becoming smaller and smaller. And as we see these things, what we find is most of them don't go to regulated market. They will sell it to the village traders who come to the villages and buy their produce. Now, if this is going to continue, and of course, you know, the bills allow for that, over a period of time, in case the APMCs become very weak, then we have the problems of reference price. If there are no good price discovery that is happening, because if people are coming to, let's say, farmers, small farmers, negotiate and so on, and bargaining power of small farmers is lower, and if there is no good reference price, then essentially they will be at a disadvantage, this one. So that's one of the fear from this bill. What could have been done? I think a few things. Again, we need to look at the current system and what's happening and why things don't work. And therefore, what could have been done is something we can think about. Let's say, you know, there is some assumption that, you know, by removing all these, farmers will be able to use private market, electronic trading, and so on. But the very fact that, you know, the internet services are very poor in rural area, which will constrain farmers in terms of really using the electronic media. We have not paid much attention to rural area in terms of communication, telecommunication, and so on to even today, because of various reasons, there is a very poor connectivity in rural areas, especially with respect to data connectivity. If the data connectivity is not there, then how farmers will be able to take advantage of e-commerce is a big question that we need to address. The other things are, for example, warehouse based sales. I think one could have been much more forceful in terms of making sure that, let's say, warehouse based sales takes place. The APMCs could be converted into more of a warehouse based sales and so on. But that emphasis is not still there. That, of course, requires one is good grades and standards, good assaying facilities, and also good warehousing system. Now, in all these, we are very weak. So we do not have a proper grades and standards system. There are multiple agencies having grades and standards, but really we don't have a common agreement as to which one of these grades should be used by the trade. And of course, people use different standards, and that leads to a whole lot of confusion in the marketplace. There also, it becomes very difficult to communicate information about prices to different stakeholders. So that's one area that needs to be done. The second area is actually in terms of assaying facilities. What is the best way of assaying? There has to be a lot of innovation that has to come in order to make assaying very quick and effective, cost effective. If these things are done, then the warehouse based sales can also happen in a bigger way. If warehouse based sales are there, if there is a NWR system, that is negotiable warehouse receipt system, then farmer can take his produce and keep it in the warehouses and get it graded and get a receipt. Then he or she can sell the produce whenever the trading platform gives a reasonable price to the farmers. And meanwhile, they can always get a pledge loan from the banks and so financial institutions. But this arrangement is, we have been talking for a long time, but has not been in a proper shape even now. The NWR that are being supposedly implemented in warehouses, they do not really have the proper system of grades and standards and maintaining the grades and standards. So these things are somehow not addressed, but these are some very key things. If you want to really make traders or one market, one country kind of a thing, these are important, because if grade standards are there, then anybody from anywhere can buy it. If there are no grade standards, everybody has different grade standards and so on, it really leads to a lot of confusion. That's how our whole marketing system is full of intermediaries, because you need to go and inspect and then see, which grade it belongs to, and therefore it automatically requires more number of intermediaries in the system. And of course, the marketing cost as well. So that's another area, major area that one has to really pay attention to. We need to have research. Public institutions should really come up with appropriate ways of grading and standardizing different commodities. We have more, the varieties, too many varieties are there and so on. We need to also come up with grades and standards for these different varieties. The other thing is about for perishables, especially we need pack houses. So again, we have seen that if you look at grapes export and so on, it is because of this infrastructure we were able to do very well. Of course, it's not, it's done by the farmer producer organizations and to some extent the state government collaboration and so on. But those infrastructure is very, very important in order to really make or streamline the agriculture marketing system. But focus should be on these things. I think that would help in improving the efficiency in the marketing system, and therefore be able to reduce the marketing cost and therefore increase higher price realization for farmers and reduce the cost to the consumers as well. So those are things that I thought we should have focused a lot more on. Just coming back to the core of the bills, what is important is how do you convert the existing APMCs into much more efficient system of marketing, as well as I think we may have to move towards more of agribusiness centers. The APMCs become more of agribusiness centers providing several kinds of services. It may have grading and standardization, assaying facilities, good warehousing facilities with the NWR, as well as value addition. So these are things which the APMCs can offer and really make it a very vibrant marketing system in order to attract farmers from their own localities or nearby places. So if that happens, then whatever is done is good. But I think one has to think about how APMCs would really convert themselves into a vibrant agricultural markets. Thank you.
Tangents of the issues. You have given the grades and standardization. You have talked about the internet, the basic thing, the internet connectivity and all those things, and the market, the revamping of APMC sort of thing. So basically, what I see about these three pieces of legislation, government seeks to create a kind of cafeteria approach where the farmers, whatever is the existing system in place, APMC just as an example, they will continue to exist in whatever form, whatever worth it is, but they are creating any additional options. So the essence of these three legislation is freedom of choice, and the farmers are being empowered in the sense they have more choices to make from, as if we go in the cafeteria, whatever was earlier available, the rice, wheat, and the vegetable, chicken, whatever. But then they are providing few new dishes. Similarly, farmers are being empowered to have few more choices, and whatever the flaw they exist, they obviously warrant that to be set right. But you have touched very important points on this, and if time permits, we will come back to again to you and other. May I now request Professor Meenakshi Raji? Is she ready? I'm not able to see you, Professor Meenakshi.
Hello, sir. Am I audible now?
Yeah. Please. So the same question, Professor Meenakshi, as we talk. Yeah.
Let me first begin by thanking IGRO for giving me this opportunity, especially Professor Charan Singh, bringing all of us together. Now, in India, actually, we have various bills, schemes, committee reports, etc., which are always formulated quite carefully and with well intentions. And these bills also, I consider, in that category, that there is, as you said, that there is more choices will be given to the farmers. But it is also well known stays. And I have stayed at the macro level about these bills, and I will speak briefly from some ground level experiences about certain implementation issues which we need to actually take care of if we want to actually these bills to really help farmers. And to my mind, it's very important to look at the small and marginal farmers. They are about 80 to 90% amongst our farming community, and they are the one who are really, and therefore we have to see whether we can give a better deal to them or not. Now, if we look back in marketing and government policies, and APMC system, if you look at the government document, I see that the APMCs were introduced in order to save the farmers from the distressed sale, from their creditors, and protect from the exploitation of intermediaries. That's but then when we developed this infrastructure of APMCs, we did not kind of develop in a manner which can really be the small and marginal. Actually allowed private yards and direct contract farming, etc. And several states have actually adopted these provisions also. And Karnataka is one state which also adopted various provisions. But then we do not see a lot of noise, but we do not see much change in the ground situation as far as farmers' conditions are concerned. Professor Singh, a lot of noise is coming, sir.
Yeah.
Then in the government budget in 2018, government announced that farmers will now get 1.5 time cost of production as their value of output. And at that time, we also wrote about it, that how this will be operationalized, basically price deficiency payment, how a farmer selling at a lower price, how would he prove, how would he get the deficiency payment, etc. And it was said in the budget that 22,000 rural huts will be upgraded to Grameen agriculture market, and a corpus of 2000 crore was allocated for marketing facilities. But at the ground level, actually farmers' payment did not improve very much. And then we also have side by side electronic platform, e-NAM platform, where APMCs were also playing important. That about 14% of farmers were registered there, and about half of them were actually using the facilities. So then the perhaps large or medium farmers were using that, and smaller farmers did not get the opportunity or could not take help of this. Now we have these three bills which allows, as Dr. Asuk was telling, that it allows much more opportunities and have potential, because it improves competitive, and as we know that competitive outcomes are always Pareto efficient, everybody is better off. But then in a market to be competitive, economic theory tells us that it has to satisfy certain basic features. One is large number of buyers and sellers, number two, homogeneous commodity, number three, free flow of information, and number four, no transaction or no reduced transaction costs. So these, I take these four very important features of competitive market. And first, looking at the large number of buyer-sellers. Of course, the sellers are in large numbers because half of our population is in agriculture, but we have a large number of buyers really to push up the price. That's the important question. And many argue that the commission agents at the APMC go now and buy from the farmers, or the farmers would continue to sell in the village traders, because about perhaps 25% of transactions were happening through APMCs and 55.9% were happening through traders, either formally or informally anyway. So therefore, that may take, continue to take place. As far as contract farming is concerned, I give some ground level information from Karnataka. Karnataka has adopted provisions of Model APMC Act 2003, and also a state where there are large number of retail chain, relatively much larger number. And there is a study Isaac done by Mr. Kedar, and which actually shows there is no definite figure of what percentage of farmers are actually benefiting from such retail chain based or such contract farming, and it shows that not even 1%, less than 1%. So even if it increased 10 times, about 2-3% farmers may be benefiting from such activities. Therefore, in order for a competition to really take place and have a kind of competitively push up the price to a good level, we need about 20-25% people going and buying from these farmers. And secondly, if we look at the APMC Act, I don't want to speak much, but Professor Sukpal Singh also have talked about it. Also, the ground level, some of the study, recent study published by Pitt and Kannan, which did some farmer level interviews and kind of discussion with farmers, shows that the private investment for infrastructure has not come to the extent they desired. Fruit and vegetable houses were quite far off, and
not audible, sir. Hello, ma'am. Hello.
Yeah. Should we? Should I connect her on telephone and see if she can speak here?
Now it's audible.
Okay.
Hello, Meenakshi.
Therefore, we look at the farmer producer group, let me repeat that about around 5,000, there are different figures, but I would assume about 5,000 are working with 500 members on an average, then only a few lakhs of farmer only are benefiting. And this is something also we need to really improve. And at the ground level, if we want to really give better price to small and marginal farmers. In the group activities, that we have seen some success, but the farmer joint liability group or FPO, large scale prevalence, that success we are yet to see. Coming to the second aspect, which is the homogeneity of in the issue of quality of products, and Isaac's study that I talked about, farmers face a lot of problems when they deal with this, retail houses, which these farmers in terms of quality, and many a times they say that quality is not good, and farmer therefore had to sell in the open market at a much lower price. So this is one area which is a problematic area for small and marginal farmer. The third aspect is the flow of information, competitive, the four aspects I have said. The APMC system actually provided a platform where and some price discovery was happening, whether it was a very good price or whatever. And the study, ground level study at Isaac, shown that the retail houses were playing slightly higher price than the APMC price. Now, if the APMC system become weaker, then this price discovery process will go, and it may take some time for this farmers, this kind of information to become available to farmer. And this is one area where we really need to work on. And that brings me to the important issue of transaction cost. And the second bill talks about this control, this process, and there will be legal framework that will be established, etc., etc. But then we see that from Mr. Kedar's study, we see that the when the farmers' outputs were rejected by these retail houses through contract farming, then farmers need to and negotiate with him, and sometimes they is actually about 14% of his total turnover, and which I consider as quite high. And therefore, this is another area where we need to work on in order to give a better deal to small and marginal farmer. The legal framework strengthening may help, but whether a small farmer will be able to really negotiate with a big corporate house such as Reliance Fresh or something like that is something we really need to see. And therefore, to conclude that from this, some of these ground level studies and experiences, we see that there is a possibility that we, in order to benefit the farmer. And the Committee of Sectors for Agriculture Market back in 2010 also say that complete deregulation may not help. There may be some necessity of intervention. And we have rural huts, which are large in number, 4 to 5 times higher than perhaps the APMC mandis that we have. And it is necessary to develop some of these markets, because we do not know how the markets will, and it is very necessary to develop rural non-farm sector side by side, especially the food processing sector, and relate these local markets with rural sector. And here I conclude by stating some NSSO enterprise in the food processing sector, around 90% enterprises are in the informal sector. And out of that, about 80% are own account enterprises. That means they do not have any hired labor. The basic subsistence level, you look at value added, you see that there's a Swiss this time will not help much, and therefore we need a kind of really concerted effort to develop this non-farm sector and relate it to village markets, develop these markets. And if we want to the farmers, and I see, I want to conclude by saying that all these efforts we have to do consistently for some time in order to get a better result.
Thank you, Meenakshi. You gave a very good landscape of this, these three pieces, and we will come back to you. There may be a few questions. May I now invite Dr. Ladish to kindly give his perspective on these three pieces of legislation and the reforms. Dr. Ladish.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello. Hello. Hello.
Yes.
Am I audible?
Yes, you are.
First of all, at the outset, I would like to express my thanks to Dr. Charan Singh for giving me this opportunity to speak in this seminar webinar. Then I would also like to congratulate the team of the experts who designed these three acts in general and Dr. Ramesh Chandra in particular, who has given the shape to these bills. These bills are the landmark. Now these are acts are the landmark in the history of agriculture. And this is the, we can say, the real green marketing revolution in the country. Now these three acts together makes an important contribution in bringing the reforms in the agriculture market. The first, as we all know, the freedom of choice to the farmers, oil is produced anywhere in the country or through anyone in the country. And this makes a lot of difference to the farmers. It's a more competitive. We are entering into the perfect competition situations where farmers will be earlier having only choice APMC, and now they can go to anywhere and sell their products. So far, there are so many limitations of the APMC, as we all know. There is a problems in the APMC, and then all were telling that this monopoly of them is APMC should be scrapped, and this is the right direction. Now, my only problem with this is that when we are telling that the APMC will be, the farmers will have a more choice of the agencies, but now in the what exactly happened is that we are selling the other agency, there would be no market fee, whereas the APMC will continue with the market fee. So psychologically, farmer, if they are charging 2.5, or in some state it's much more than 5%, then they will not come to the APMC, and sooner or later, APMC will be not on the scene. And then farmers will not have the reliable friends, who is a, what I call it, the agency of the last resort, where he can go and market his product. So what I feel that if, though it's a reforms, it's a continuous process, and it's not the end in itself. Now, either what we should do is, the other agencies should also charge the market fee, which is applicable in the APMC area, or the government should reimburse to the APMCs that market fee which loss they would be having. The state government, they should reimburse the state government, so APMC can continue on the scene. That is my first observations. Then I come to the another aspects. As we all know, the consumer, the share of the producer in the consumer rupees in the three system of the marketing are totally different. In case of a trader or the APMC, where there is a cartel of the we can say a commission agent or arbitrage, where farmer is not getting his produce, or he has to market as soon as harvest is there, and then the consumer is paying through the nose later on. So now if you look at the this system, around 42 or even less than 40% of the consumer rupee is going to the producer in case of a trader. In case of a cooperatives, it ranges from the 40% to the 75%. Best Amul cooperatives, they give the 75% of the consumer rupee to the producer. But the problem with the cooperative is that they are having the leadership problems. They are also having the problems of bureaucracy. And as a result, the cooperatives are not the good source or the not the good agency to promote the interest of the farmers. My own observation is that this non-credit cooperatives in the per year. So how long we will continue with this system? So Dr. Kurian and others, the thought of the producer companies came on the scene, and now producers companies are doing well. The particularly I'm talking about the rural dairy cooperatives in the producer sector. They are giving the 85% of the consumer rupee to the producers. So needless to say that producers companies are the best choice. But the problem is that they have not been allowed to have a competition with the system. Because if you look at the cooperatives get a lot of state support, including in the dairy sector or in any sector, they get the lot of subsidy and lot of the things. So in case of a dairy cooperatives, the anytime state government, because they are registered under the state act, so anytime they will declare the subsidy for the milk or feed, animal feed also, they will give the subsidy. And that is how the many of the farmers are attracted toward the cooperative. Do they know the best choice is the producer company? So what I feel is that there should be a level playing field for these institutions. If we want that producer institutions should come playing field, the whatsoever state government, because these companies are registered under the Central Act, so they are not getting any support from the center, they are not getting any support from the state as well. So they are at a disadvantageous position as compared to the cooperatives. So my request is, my suggestion is that if we are really interested that farmers, these producers companies should be promoted, we have to give them a level playing field. Not only, even if you look at the central, the income tax. Now Income Tax Act provides some concession in the tax that those companies which are having this turnover of the 1,000 crore, they will be getting the exemption in the income tax for the 5 years. But there are the companies which are having the, say, as high as 1 lakh members in the dairy sector. And if that is the situation, then this we are discouraging the large size economy in the system. So I feel that there should be some level playing field, not only that one-to-one, or there should be some package for promotion of these producers' organizations so that they can compete in the market and they can give the fair price to the farmers. Coming to the most controversial aspect of the MSP, yes, I also agree where MSP is a relic of the past. We cannot continue this. But at the same time, we should not forget how far farmer will produce at the loss. For how many years he will continue to make the loss. So we should protect his cost of cultivation. And how best you can do this? The one way out was the MSP. There. Another way out is that you ensure through what we call it a price insurance. What sort of price farmer is able to, if there is a fall in the price or existing price, we have to protect the farming should not be a loss-making profession. So you either what sort of way you adopt, whether it is through the MSP or it is through the price insurance or it should be through the Bhavantar. The Bhavantar is another scheme which has been tried in some of the states, particularly in Madhya Pradesh, where if there is a fall in the price as compared to the MSP, this difference is compensated. So there is a need for having the APMC, because the Bhavantar should be managed better by the APMC. So either Bhavantar or through the price insurance, or through the MSP, whatsoever is there, farming should be not a loss-making business if we are really interested in the welfare of the farmers. Coming to the fourth point, about the Essential Commodities Act. Yes, it's a step in the right direction. We should have done it long ago, but we could not do it because the always fear is that there would be a price rise and essential commodities are needed by the consumers. So it is more in the interest of the consumer rather than the farmers. My suggestion is, when I was looking through this, they say if there is a 50% rise in case of a horticulture produce or other perishables, and 50% rise in the case of the non-perishable commodities, then government will swing into action and
sorry to interrupt you, Dadi. It's not 50% in case of horticulture, it's 100% increase.
100% horticulture and 50% in case of a non-perishable good.
Yeah, right.
So this is a 50%. I'm sorry, I might have used the word 50%. It is 100% and 50%, and whichever is lower. Now, and then how they would be calculating is from the either 12 months preceding months or 5 years average price.
I think we should not go into the too many detailed microscopic. We are broadly discussing the broad parameter. There is another speaker, and there will be let us wind up, because another speaker, the panelist,
okay, fine, is thank you. Okay, thank you very much, nice of you, thanks.
Yeah. Thank you. Okay. Dr. Dadish, you have raised very, very important point. And on behalf of EGRO, I thank you very much. Because of paucity of time, I'm sorry to have interrupted you.
No problem.
So then there are many questions also. So before that, may I open the floor to Professor Lakhvinder Singh, and to give your esteemed view on this. Then we'll come to the question. May I request, kindly restrict yourself to the 10 minutes.
Okay. Thank you very much, Ashok ji, for inviting me to speak to very learned audience and very highly specialized audience. Before I would like to put forward my view, I would like to express my gratitude to Dr. Charan Singh, who has persuaded me to come to this kind of forum and listen to very learned speaker, those who have worked in the agriculture marketing for a long period of time. So I have been a student of industrial economics and agriculture. Recently I have been picking up, but some of my observations are related to some of the aggregative issues which we should have been taking into consideration. The first issue I would like to flag with all of you is that agriculture is not an isolation which we should able to evaluate. The reforms which are being undertaken, we should not take in isolation. We must able to understand a long period of transition of the Indian economy, where you'll find that agriculture sector is being marginalized over a long period of time. Although the production is rising, but the value addition to the economy is declining. So relative decline of the agriculture sector is substantive, and you will find that in the recent years the cost of production is very high and prices are not able to keep pace, and therefore you will find that they are turning into loss kind of business. So this is one of the very important paradigm. You will find that how crisis indebtedness of the farming community need to be addressed. So I was thinking that when any government of the country is going to take up the issue of reforms, they must understand and take up the issue of what problems the particular sector of the economy is facing. So if we have to, you know, continue agriculture to subsidize the consumption to the consumers, And you will find that making transition from a backward economy to a modern economy, industrialized, and then you will find service-oriented economy, then we have to understand that there is a need to transfer the population from the agriculture to other sector of the economy. If population continue to stay back, and you know the man-land ratio is falling, and then you will find that the profitability is not keeping pace. Therefore, you will find that agriculture and the agrarian community is expected to remain in losses, and losses are very difficult to bear for a long period of time. The role of the minimum support price was to at least protect the minimal risk as well as secure the food security of the country. I would like to flag to all of you that food security by the United Nations has defined as a component of the national security of the country. So therefore, you'll find that in the even the sustainable development goals, you will find that these goals have been included, and the responsibility of the Indian government is that we have to provide food security as well as safety as well as nutrition security to the population at large, which I think we have been a deficit for a long period of time and slipping to a very low position in international comparisons. The second point I would like to submit to all of you is that global economy experiences with us. The food shortages usually happens, and food control is by the monopolies. If we are looking today that markets can do everything, I think that we must take into consideration that the food trade, which is taking place globally, historical experiences, whenever India went for food buying, you will find that prices go skyrocketing. When India is exporting, prices goes down. So I think that India has to take care of such important issue when you are changing laws and dismantling the older structure which we have evolved over a long period of time. That was revolving around the food security of the country, and today I can say that India is not yet food secure, and therefore you'll find that if India is not food secure, and pandemic has shown that how your basic goods which has been transported from a state like Punjab, you will find that a huge amount of food was needed and transferred from the state of Punjab. So I think that the kind of infrastructure which enacted by particular kind of states in India like Punjab, you will find that you do not have the market yards anywhere in other states of the country like Punjab has been able to develop those. Not only the market yards are required, the supporting infrastructure is required so that the produce must reach to the market at a very early stage, with a little time difference. I think that the new reforms are not taking into consideration that infrastructure is the most important aspect of, you know, how markets transactions are actually being conducted. And you'll find that the third very important aspect which I would like to submit before the august audience is that you will find that agriculture is not a regular kind of activities, that you will find that it is a gestation period of between the crop which is being sown and the crop that is being harvested. So during the harvesting period of time, usually it happens gluts are coming, and during the glut period, the prices given to the market, allowing the market to function, the prices are expected to crash. Therefore, the share of the producer going to be very little, but you will find that the intermediary who is going to store the product, trade the products, they are going to have the large share of the pie. And therefore, in these laws, you will find that nothing is there which one can look into that this protection is available there. The next very important aspect which I would like to submit before all of you is that the kind of system which we have been talking about is that the regulatory mechanism and the dispute settlement mechanism given in the laws, given in the acts. I think that it is highly bureaucratic oriented. The central government of India is always talking about our bureaucracy is the most inefficient bureaucracy in the world, and they would like to induct other than the kind of bureaucratic arrangement which we have made. So therefore, you will find that in the acts, when you are talking about the dispute settlement, you will find that highly dependence is on the bureaucracy, as bureaucracy is not indulging in corruption. The bureaucracy is highly people oriented, and the bureaucracy is very efficient, and dispute settlement is going to be very efficient and also without any cost. I think this is a huge kind of negative kind of arrangements which has been made, and civil courts are prohibited to consider this disputes. I think that if I would like to give you the grassroots cases in Punjab, the you will find that sugar cane mills are priced, sugar cane is being contracted, and you will find that the payments are not made for a year or so. So then you will find that the farmers unions are going to the civil courts to settle these kind of disputes. But today you will find that in these acts, it is very derogatory that you will find that every dependence has been given to from the local level to the national level, that the bureaucracy is considered to be going to settle the dispute, as that you will find that is a that is a kind of organization which is already have a long experience of dispute settlement between the farmers and the traders. And the next point I would like to bring to your notice is the farmer and trader. You'll find that it is being advocated that the reforms are being done, that the farmers can do transaction, the primary producers can do transactions intrastate as well as interstate. But cleverly, it is the wholesale trader is going to bring in. And if you see, APMC has an intermediary. Do you think that trade can run without intermediaries? Nowhere in the world I have seen that trade is without intermediary. Therefore, you will find that the producer and the final consumers, you will find that a huge amount of the intermediaries are there. You will find that the differences between the producer and the consumer are huge, not only in agriculture itself, but also in many other products, which we can say the products which we are even white goods. So you'll find that the intermediaries are there, and intermediaries, whenever trade happens, intermediaries are going to be there. So are those intermediaries are going to be less exploitative? What mechanism has been instilled in it? This is not clear at all. I think that the traders are allowed freely, and I think that any trade which happens where in the world the trade happens without, you will find that any paying any charges or taxes. You know that this is a free trade where it is happening in the world, where you will find that during trade no tax charges are there. So I think that it is strangely to dismantling the present structure which has evolved over a long period of time, as well as the official purchase system which has been developed, and minimum support price to cover the risks of the farmers, which has been not remunerative but at least stability to production. You will find that all these kind of advantages which earlier system have, now you will find that that system has to face the disadvantages. Therefore, the agriculture sector, even though Professor Sukhpal has argued that it is not going to be in the hands of the corporates, but my hunch is that the agriculture produce, the agriculture trade, the agriculture processing is going to be completely monopolized, and therefore we need a strong regulatory mechanism that this should not happen. So the fear which today farming community, and you'll find that it is very important to understand that why the farming community is having a different view compared to the political leadership. And I think that this is a fundamental problem, that what is offered and what actually going to happen. The farmers have a historical experience, because the farming is in crisis from the last 30 years period of time. Their crisis is not being addressed, and therefore you'll find that this is a fundamental problem which is not addressed. The last point I would like to make and conclude, that is, you'll find that the suspicion of these reforms happens when ordinance was brought in the month of June, and you will find that it is hush up in a hush hush manner. It is concluded in terms of acts, and you will find that larger amount of consultations which were expected to happen has not happened. Therefore, the stakeholders in a democratic society, the stakeholders are usually expected to be consulted. And therefore, you'll find that the experts, they are very valued persons in the society. They do question also what is happening. But you'll find that, unfortunately, the large number of experts are, you'll find that only talking about praising everything. They do not understand the mechanism which is given. You'll find that any person who know the ABC of economics, perhaps the free market is not going to deliver. It is going to ruin the society, economy, and ultimately polity, because you will find that the population dependent on agriculture sector is very large. If we will not care, if we are not taking care of, you will find that the society may move towards a civil strife, which perhaps will be having a huge amount of consequences, which perhaps no government, no country, no nation is expected to afford. Thank you very much.
Different perspective from others, and then among those five panelists, we got a very good inputs, and then everybody had. But I think these things put together gives a different perspective and give the comprehensive view of this. There are many questions, but I'm afraid we are running short of time. And there are many questions on the MSP. And let me, based on the questions I am receiving, let me outset clarify few things on MSP, because I have also soiled my hands being in the chairman of CSEP, so I know few things about the costing. Now, the MSP, some participants are asking why government has to intervene for fixing the minimum support price when no commodity other than the agriculture, the prices are fixed by the government. It has to be fixed by the producer. The simple answer is this: MSP is not the maximum support price or maximum selling price. It's not MRP. It's the floor price minimum. And if the farmers have better price being offered, they can always go. So it's a binding on one side. Only government is under obligation to buy at the MSP, but the seller has no obligation. So this makes it very clear. Now, I put another question which participant has sent to Professor Gopal. The participants are asking, the agriculture is a state subject. How come the central government has brought these legislation? So over to Gopal Nair.
Well, I think this is a question which a court should answer. You know, who has the right to make legislation? Generally, markets, agriculture marketing is a state in the state jurisdiction. But with the Parliament Act, I don't know exactly what the the kind of power that the parliament has in terms of really coming up with an act which would be basically taking away the power of the state. So that's something I think for courts to decide. I won't be able to say much.
Yeah, may I ask the same question to Professor Sukhpal? Can you throw some light on this?
Sukhpal, I can't hear you.
Sorry.
You can't hear me?
Yeah, I am able to hear you.
But I heard some disturbance. Yeah.
Maybe you repeat.
Yes. Okay. So yeah. I'm saying that the union government has used an entry in the union list, which is titled Trade and Commerce, and it lists many food stuffs and names them. And agricultural produce has been treated as if it is a product, industrial product, and that has been used to frame laws. So we have to see how courts look at it. Yeah, so that's how it is done. Yeah.
Now another question is, how do you say that MSP should be mandatory? Because in your intervention, you mentioned the MSP should be legally binding. Can you rationalize or give some justification for this? Because that MSP has been invoked from 1965, and we have been doing, I mean, the government has been in the business of MSP for last 55 years, and it has never been a statutory, it has been by way of government notification. So can you give some more elaborate on this, why it should be mandatory for the
this person is to whom?
So sorry, Professor Sukhpal.
Yeah, so I didn't say that should be mandatory. I said that it should not be.
You said you I should said not be.
It the MSP should not be a legal right.
It should not be legal, right? That's fine. Yeah. That's fine.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that's fine. And there is another question on, there is an apprehension in the minds of participants that if the contract farming is entered into, the farmers do not have wherewithal to negotiate and get the best price from the big corporates and those who will having the contract farming. How to protect farmers, because they don't have the negotiating power. And so the question is open to all the panelists. So anybody can, because it's not addressed to particular panelists. So may I request Meenakshi to reply, and then Lakhvinder Singh.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Now, yes. This is really, this can be really a problem, which I have already spoken about. If the contract, until and unless there is competition among these contract farming agencies, and they bid up the price, otherwise the price cannot go up. An alternative way, as I said, is that farmers as a group, if they can negotiate, then only they can have a better price. But if there are contract agencies, earlier, as I said, that in the Karnataka example, we saw that the contract agencies, they state some price, but then they do not give that price at the end of the day. And then the farmer really need to negotiate with these contract agencies. And as an individual farmer, they find it difficult to negotiate. And that time, the APMCs provided a kind of a benchmark, and these contract agencies paid a price a slight higher than this APMC price. But now APMC becoming weakened, we do not know how the price mechanism or discovery process will come about. And therefore, this is a genuine, I think, concern. And unless farmers together can negotiate or regulatory framework put into place in a structured manner, that's another alternative of a regulatory framework putting in place, which can perhaps help the farmers.
Thank you, Meenakshi ji. Dr. Dadij, you talked about the income tax exemption for a certain period. Are you in, Dr. Dadij?
Yeah.
So there is a question for you also. They say the income tax exemption up to turnover of ₹100 crores for 5 years. And how it's going to help our the farmers and on the agriculture sector as a whole? Can you give more?
Actually, suppose it is given to all the producer institutions, irrespective of the size of the turnover, whatsoever profit they are earning. As you know, producer companies are distributing the profit among the farmers as a, what they call it, at the end, the difference between the price which they determine in the beginning of the year, that this much price will be given at the end of the year. If they have earned more, that money is given to them. So if income tax is not levied on the company, and that part will be available to the farmer, so farmers' income will grow. Now, as you rightly told, if farmers' income grows, then demand side, because farmers will be purchasing all these items. So even agriculture items, that would be higher the agriculture items, or in this way, the economy, if farmers' income goes up, the economy will flourish. And this is how, if more and more income is, say, income tax rebate, whenever there is a demand increase in the economy, so similar way, farmers should also be given the income. So otherwise, what happens, that the income tax, they levy the income and farmers get the less. Am I clear now?
Yeah. Okay, fine. Because of paucity of time, there are many questions, but I will restrict to two questions. One to Professor Lakhvinder and another to Professor Gopalji. Lakhvinder, there is a question which says that opening up our markets without ensuring bargaining power of the farmer may go against the interest of the farmer, given the socio-economic dynamics of the rural area. What is your take on this? And I think Professor Sukhpal ji and Professor Lakhvinder both can answer. The question is same, but you can give your answer could be different. So first to Professor Lakhvinder and then to Professor Sukhpal.
Ashok ji, I would like to submit on the experience we have today with us. The contract farming is in a very small in nature, but the producers which are producing and bringing the produce to the market, they are very large in number, but they are very small in size. So what we have seen, that when the big firms comes to contracting the output of the producers, they usually falter, and you will find that there is no mechanism existing with or in the new laws that exist which can protect the farmers. So I think that the fundamental problem with the agriculture is that when farmer produces, they are considered to be oppressors or to the consumers as well as to the government, and they considered to be really monopolists. I think that is the kind of notion which these laws are being enacted, that is making the primary producer as at the receiving ends. Therefore, the creating uncertainty, fluctuating in prices, I think that the farming stability in production is at stake. So I think that is, and especially where the bulk products are being produced. For example, in the state of Punjab, when the food grains are being produced, I cannot see a private producer who can pay even the minimum price. We are witnessing the cotton crop, we are witnessing even the maize crop. You will find that nowhere even the half price is being given to private buyers. So where they will go in terms of if huge losses occurs, who is at the rescue of the farmers? And if income declines, I think that the economy is going to have a less effective demand, and you will find that other sectors of the economies are also going to be affected. So I think that stability of the primary producer is going to be very important in terms of ensuring the price as well as the risk, so that it has they have the minimum possible income for a decent living.
Okay, thank you very much. Professor Sukpal, can I ask the same question to you? Maybe you have a different perspective on that point.
Okay, so as I said earlier, contract farming is definitely a desirable channel. India needs it, but the way we are getting it is problematic. For example, nobody questioned Punjab having a contract, separate contract farming act in 2013 itself. Suddenly now it becomes negative. Punjab introduced contract farming to India and perishables, and hundreds and thousands of farmers have been using and benefited from it. I have not yet come across a farmer who can say I lost in contract farming. They wanted more, perhaps companies could not continue giving more. Now let me tell you, contract farming is not about price alone. If anybody is looking at that, then we are missing the bus. Contract farming can also be about yield enhancing technology and seeds. It can be also cost reduction. It can be also about crop diversification. So let's not look at contract farming as a price channel alone. So contract farming can do a lot of good in the situation of India where we are stuck with all the problems in agriculture sector, provided we regulate it well. The Contract Farming Act lacks in very many ways. For example, the only thing it protects farmer against is say your land is protected, and if your payments are not made, the company will be penalized. That's all. There are so many things I mentioned. Contract farming, very sophisticated arrangement these days. All that is not even talked about. Most important, I have been arguing for group contracts for the last 20 years. Neither we have it as part of policy nor as regulation. How can you make 2-acre, 3-acre farmer compete, if at all? First of all, my take is they will never be part of these channels by and large. So they are not attractive to companies. If they want to be attractive to companies, they have to come together. Two group contracts like Gujarat farmers are doing here in potato with Pepsi and others. So you have to create platforms. FPOs can negotiate on behalf of farmers with companies and give them a large number of farmers. But protection of farmer interest is lacking in this act, which need to be enhanced in so many ways.
Yeah, thank you. It's a very good perspective. There is another question for Lakhvinder particularly. Lakhvinder, are you listening?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. They ask when the protests are more intense in Punjab and Haryana, what are the reasons for the same? Because we are not hearing much protest other than these two states, but they are more intense.
Yes, I think that that is the real issue which one should talk about, and we should understand that the Punjab and Haryana are the traditional green revolution states of India. They have been contributing to the national security in terms of providing food security for a long period of time. They have sacrificed a lot of natural resources, water as well as environment and soil degradation, but you will find they stood for the country for a long period of time. Now the kind of evolutionary framework in which the food grain system has been erected and procured, today they find that without taking into confidence to them, this is being dismantled. And that is the kind of friction between the politicians who are usually supporting, as well as those intellectuals who are also supporting the kind of laws which are enacted which are going against the basic interest of the farmers, and you'll find that without providing them the minimum possible alternative way to move out of it, I would like to educate the audience at this moment that Punjab in the mid-80s observed that you'll find that their food perhaps in the near future will not be required for the country. They would like to diversify, and they put up a plan to both the Punjab government and Punjab government discussed with the central government. The central government put a priority that the food security is the first priority of the country, and therefore you cannot diversify. So I think that if the state of Punjab has been and Haryana has been standing within a long period of time, you'll find that without taking into their interest, you keep on changing the laws in a manner which is going to adversely affect to them. So therefore, none of the political parties standing with them, and no, they are not with the political parties, farmers themselves voluntarily, and you see the children, the young, the old, and the who provide outside agriculture, all are with them to protest, and you'll find that they would like that the minimum possible changes are required in these two, in three acts, which is going to protect the interest of the farming community in the agriculture, food grain dominated states of India.
Thank you, Lakshminder ji. Now, one last question. I am conscious of the fact that we are overshooting the time, but nevertheless, I cannot resist the temptation of asking another question before I let everybody to go. Professor Gopal, there is one question for you, and probably that will be the last one. You talked about the standardization and grading of the commodities. And when there is one nation, one market, how do you decide? Because the price has to be with the specific, with reference to the quality. And for ensuring the same quality, we have to have the same standard, same grading. Just to give an illustration, the rice, the common rice or the premium rice can be sold at the prices of 18 rupees a kg up to 250 rupees a kg. Of course, variety changes. So, when you are having the online transaction and having one nation, one market, how do you ensure the grade and the quality?
Grades and qualities are not with respect to, you know, making it just few grades and you know, closing. It's actually in terms of, you know, for individual variety, let's say basmati rice and let's say the non-basmati rice, two different rice varieties. Of course, even in the non-basmati there are several varieties. One can think of, you know, grading in the varieties itself, similar varieties put together, and have a grid standard for you know, these individuals, right? Similarly, in cotton, you know, the staple length will be different. So, for different staple lengths, you have great standard for different staple lengths. So, you know, some parameters will be very common. For example, moisture or foreign matter or immature grains. So, those will be common across these varieties. So, what you will have to identify is a variety and grade. So that's how you can actually, you know, bring in a whole host of varieties that we have and, you know, offer it on a e-trading platform.
At this point, let me say all these five panelists have presented wonderful perspective on such a complex subject like agriculture. There are so many complexities, so many parameters, so many stakeholders, and then you have given a very, very broad perspective, but at the same time there are a common thread which is running through all these perspectives. I am thankful to Professor Sukhpal ji, Gopal Nair, Lakhvinder, Dadi, and Madam Meenakshi Raji. I am also thankful to my eGrow CEO, Professor Charan Singh, our chairman, Dr. Virmani, my other two directors, Dr. MP Singh, Dr. Ratan Chan, and all the participants. And of course, I know Professor Ramesh Chand was there, but then he has to leave for a little earlier because of other engagement. And all the participants who had been there with us, and they were listening very, very intensively and with a great intent. And I'm sure everybody had enjoyed it. And then all of you, I salute one and all my panelists who spoke so passionately and without any particular bias, because they were saying what they believe in it. And therefore, the passion comes, and it was visible. They spoke straight from the heart. And I'm thankful to all of you and to all my participants. And I'm sorry to those participants whose question I could not take it because of paucity of time. But nevertheless, thanks to all of them, even those who asked the question but could not be answered because of paucity. And but that shows the level of interest they have. So it's not farmer. I think farming and the agriculture is the lifeblood of Indian economy. And this sector was the only in the extreme difficult situation in the first quarter of the current financial year. This was the only sector which registered the positive growth. That shows how much resilience we have in the agriculture despite all odds. And there are few questions on how our agri export will be taken, and because obviously I could not take up this question. And I must tell that all good things in life come to an end, and this particular webinar cannot be an exception. And we have to wind up things. Once again, thanks to all. And but before I let anybody to go, I would request Professor Charan Singh, who has few announcements to make, and over to Professor Charan.
First of all, let me thank Professor Ashok Vishwandas for having conducted and anchored this very, very important session. Each one of you have spoken with passion, including the moderator, and each one of you have been very, very frank and honest. I really thank each one of you from the core of my heart. We will be putting this recording on our website by 10 a.m. tomorrow. If you wish to use it for your students or anywhere else, you're most welcome to use it. This has been a very precious one. I'm sure policymakers are going to refer to this, as you know that they had already joined us on the discussion, and many more have joined us till the very end. So I'm aware of that, and I'm sure this will be a very, very good webinar. The clarity with which the speakers have presented their thoughts, I think everybody needs to listen to them. The policymakers, the politicians, the farmer associations, and the farmers themselves. While the discussion was going on, I have received a few messages. Can you please conduct a similar webinar in Punjabi or in Hindi? Now, I'm going to leave it to the panelists, including Dr. Ashok Vishwandas. If he is willing to handle it in Punjabi or in Hindi, we will come back. And in case there is any reluctance on part of any one of you, we will shelf the idea. So you can imagine the number of thoughts that you have presented, the analytical depth that you have touched, that I am getting these requests on my cell phone. You must have noticed I was engaged in it. They are asking if the same panel can come and present their views in Hindi or Punjabi. Okay, I leave you with that thought, and I will come back to you in case you all are willing together. Maybe some of you don't know Hindi. I know some of you don't even know Punjabi. I know, I can see Gopal Nair getting worried. But then, this is the type of reaction that I have got to the webinar today while you were all participating in the discussion. Now, I want to make two announcements. One announcement is The next webinar is on October 9, which is a Friday, and the topic is simply fascinating. COVID has flattened the world. And the speaker is Professor Upinder Kaur from Punjab University, Chandigarh. She's been the head of the economics department, and I have heard her earlier, solid analytical research she presents. So I welcome all of you to spare some time, same time on Friday, on COVID flattens the world. On 16th of October, we generally have these seminars only on Fridays, and we have it once a week because Farmers Bill became very important. That's why we brought it inside and did it on Mondays. On 16th of October, we have Professor Avinder Subramanian from UCLA and Anderson School of Business speaking to us on monetary and fiscal policy during COVID times. On 23rd of October, we have Professor Anjani Kocher from Stanford. And on 30th of October, we have Professor Ross from Columbia University speaking to us on housing. So all these invitations will come to you over a period of time, but the next one is on October 9, and I invite all of you to spare time on Friday, October 9, 5:30 to 7, COVID flattens the world. With this, thanks to each one of you for sparing the time to be part of the webinar today. Thank you and good night. Take care.